Welcome to iEnhance Student. iEnhance Student is a platform for law students to come here and deliver a lecture on the topic of their choice. Today we have with us Dharmi Patel from KES Jayantilal H. Patel College of Law, and her topic is rates and its types. So without wasting further time, I would request Dharmi Patel to commence with her lecture. Thank you.
Imagine a hypothetical situation where Mr. X has been arrested by the police without any lawful justification. Mr. X's family or friends have no idea about his whereabouts. Despite the inquiry, the police gives no details about his detention. Welcome to One and All. My name is Dharmi Patel, and today we will delve into the very fundamental aspect of the Constitution of India, which serves as a bulwark in protecting the liberties and rights of the citizens. Writs. So let us first understand what is a writ. A writ is a formal and a legal document that orders a person or an entity from performing or from ceasing to perform a specific act or a deed. Who has the power to issue writs? The writs can be issued by the courts, by the judges, or any entity having administrative or judicial jurisdiction. In other words, writ is a remedy. In the intricate tapestry of the Indian Constitution, writs emerge as a potent tool imbued with the power to uphold justice, ensure fairness, and safeguard the constitutional principles. Originating from the English common law tradition, writs have paved itself into the very framework of the Indian legal system through a meticulous process of evolution and adaptation. Everybody is aware of the fact that all the citizens of India have the fundamental rights which have been enshrined under Part 3 of the Constitution of India, which extends from Article 12 to 35. Along with these fundamental rights, we also have to protect and safeguard these fundamental rights. And this is called as the constitutional remedy, which has been provided under Article 32 and 226 of the Indian Constitution. So now let us understand what Article 32 and Article 226 of the Indian Constitution talks about. Article 32 mainly talks about two types of powers and rights. In the first instance, if an individual whose fundamental rights have been violated can directly approach the Supreme Court. Let's take an example. If Mr. A's fundamental right under Article 21A, right to education, has been curtailed, he has the power to approach to the Supreme Court. In instance 2, the Supreme Court under Article 32 has empowered to issue 5 types of rights, namely habeas corpus, mandamus, certiorari, prohibition, and quo warranto, which will be dealt later in the video. Article 32 empowers the Supreme Court to issue any of these writs. For the same reason, the Supreme Court is also called as the protector and guarantor of the fundamental rights. In the words of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, Article 32 has been described as the heart and the soul of Indian Constitution. The powers vested under Article 32 are analogous to the powers vested under Article 226 of the Indian Constitution. An individual whose fundamental rights have been violated can directly approach to the High Court under Article 226 of the Constitution. So, to sum up Article 32 and 226, we can say that these are the constitutional remedies that have been provided and enshrined under the Indian Constitution when one's fundamental rights have been violated. However, there is no rule as such that one must approach the High Court first and then the Supreme Court. An individual whose fundamental rights have been violated can directly approach the Supreme Court. However, in the case of Union of India versus Paul Manikim, it was said that when an individual approaches the Supreme Court first, he has to explain as to why he did not approach the High Court. Article 32 and 226 both have the power of issuance of writs. However, there are two major differences between Article 32 and Article 226. So let us understand the difference between these two articles. First, Article 32 has the power to issue writs, which is limited with respect to only the protection of the fundamental rights. whereas Article 226 has a broader scope and it can issue writs along with for any other purpose in addition to the protection of fundamental rights. For example, a writ can be issued against the decision of any administrative tribunal. The second difference is, as we know, that Article 32 falls under Part 3 of the Constitution of India, which is a fundamental right, along with it being a constitutional remedy, because Part 3 deals with fundamental rights extending from Article 12 to 35. Hence, when Article 32 falls under this part, it is also a constitutional remedy along with a fundamental right. However, Article 226 does not fall under Part 3, hence it is only a constitutional remedy and not a fundamental right. We have learned enough about writs. Now, let's move on to the different kinds of writs. There are total 5 kinds of writs which are available and enshrined under the Constitution of India, namely habeas corpus, mandamus, certiorari, prohibition and quo warranto. We will discuss each of this in detail. Habeas corpus. The first writ to be dealt today with is habeas corpus. Habeas corpus is a Latin term which means to bring the body or to have the body or to produce the body. It is one of the most powerful and the most commonly used writ. Imagine if a person has been illegally detained by the state. Through this writ, the individual himself or through his relatives or friends can approach the court and demand for his immediate release. The Supreme Court or the High Court then orders or asks the detaining authority on what basis that individual has been detained. If the Supreme Court or the High Court finds that the individual has been detained illegally, then the court may order for the immediate release of the individual. Let us understand this by an example. A person who has been arrested has to be produced before the magistrate within 24 hours. And if he is not produced so, this is a violation of Article 22 of the Indian Constitution. If the police keeps the individual who is arrested in his custody for more than 24 hours, it is an illegal detention or an arrest. In the case of Rudal Shah was the state of Bihar, the court had an individual who was already serving a sentence in the prison was given an extra 14 years of imprisonment. A writ of habeas corpus was issued and then the individual was released immediately with additionally exemplary damages. So under what condition can we say that a writ of habeas corpus cannot be issued? First, if the detention is lawful. Second, if there is a contempt of court. Third, if the detention is outside the jurisdiction of the court. And fourth, if the detention is by a competent court. Moving on further, the second type of writ is mandamus. Mandamus is a Latin term which means we command. This writ is issued against any statutory, non-statutory authorities, tribunals, universities, etc. and commanding them to perform their public duty. Let us understand this writ via a simple example. A person wants to start his own trading business. For this, he requires a license. He approaches the licensing authority. However, the licensing authority keeps on delaying the license or asks for bribe. Under this situation, the writ of mandamus can be issued by a court which can command the licensing authority to perform his public duty and give the license without any delay. Through this writ, one can command a public official to perform his public duty, which if not performed is violative of his article of his fundamental rights. Here in the above case, it was violative of Article 19(1)(g) of the Indian Constitution, which guarantees or which allows any citizen to profess, practice or carry on any trade, occupation, etc. Through this writ, one can command any public officer to perform his public duty, which in return is in violative of his fundamental rights if not performed. In the case of E Cooperative Society versus State of Maharashtra, the court opined that the writ of mandamus can be issued when the government denies itself a jurisdiction which it is ought to do under the law. one important condition, prerequisite to issue mandamus is that there must exist a public duty. Let us understand who can issue, against whom a writ of mandamus can be issued. The writ of mandamus can be issued against a public authority or a corporation or a inferior court. However, writ of mandamus can never be issued against the president or the state governor. It can also never be issued against an individual person or a chief justice of a high court who is acting in his judicial capacity, or a duty which arises out of a contractual obligation, or it cannot be issued when the duty is discretionary and not mandatory. Moving further, the third type of writ that we have is writ of certiorari. It means to be certified. This writ asks the lower court to submit their records for their review. If the Supreme Court or the High Court finds that the decision or the judgment of the lower court is illegal, then the higher courts can review its judgment. So when can a judgment be illegal? Under four circumstances, a judgment can be illegal. First, when there is a lack of jurisdiction. Second, when there is excess of jurisdiction. Third, when the jurisdiction is unconstitutional. And fourth, and lastly, when there is a violation of principles of natural justice. The writ of certiorari can be issued at the juncture when the lower court have already passed its judgment, but the higher courts feel that the judgment is illegal. In the case of A.K. Kripak versus Union of India, the Supreme Court had quashed the orders that were made by the lower courts because it felt that it was because there was a lack of jurisdiction. In 1991, the Supreme Court of India said that the writ of certiorari can also be issued against administrative authorities in addition to the judicial and quasi-judicial authorities. This writ, however, can never be issued against legislative bodies or private individuals. Moving further, the fourth type of writ is writ of prohibition. To prohibit means to forbid. The writ of prohibition can be issued by a higher court to prevent the lower court from performing or exceeding a jurisdiction or from usurping a jurisdiction that it does not possess. So, unlike mandamus, where it directs inactivity, writ of prohibition directs inactivity. I am sure everybody is familiar with the phrase prevention is better than cure. So let us understand this via this. Let us understand writ of prohibition via this example. Here in the case, prevention is a writ of prohibition and cure is the writ of certiorari. Prevention in case a writ of prohibition is issued when the higher court feels or prevents or prohibits the lower court from passing any judgment which might be in either excess of its jurisdiction, lack of jurisdiction, violation of principles of natural justice. So this is a prevention. And cure is the writ of certiorari, which after once the judgment is pronounced, the higher court quashes the judgment. That is the cure. Let us understand the writ of prohibition via a simple example. For instance, A is a child, is a minor child who has been arrested by the police, and the charge sheet has been formed, and the proceedings have been going on in the lower court. However, in this case, A, because he is a minor, he is a juvenile, the higher court will prevent or prohibit the lower court from continuing the proceedings, as he will be treated in the juvenile court like the other juvenile offenders. If the child continues his proceedings in the lower court, it will be in violation of Article 14 because the other juvenile offenders are treated in juvenile court. The last and the fifth writ is the writ of quo warranto. Quo warranto means by what authority? So let us understand what does this writ mean by way of simple example. A person holding a position of a public authority or a public position is assumed to have been qualified and eligible for the position. However, before making the appointment to the position, no advertisement was made or no applications was accepted. This is a violation of Article 16, which says that there will be equal opportunities given in case of public employment. Here, if the Supreme Court or the High Court can question the public officer that by what authority has he assumed that office. If there are title defects found in the officer's post, then the officer has to vacate his seat immediately. In the case of Niranjan Kumar versus the University of Bihar, the court stated that the writ of quo warranto cannot be issued against a person who is not holding a public office or a public post. So in simple terms, it means if a person is not holding a public position, then this writ cannot be issued against private entity. This writ also cannot be issued against a ministerial or private office. So, to sum up all the writs that we have studied, let us go through the first one. So, if you want to ask a public officer that by what authority he is holding the position, a writ of quo warranto is issued. If the higher court wants to prevent the judgment which is illegal from being passed, then one issues writ of prohibition. If the judgment has already been passed which is found to be illegal and you want the judgment to stop from coming into effect, then the writ of certiorari is to be issued. Fourth, if there is some illegal detention or arrest of a person, then the writ of habeas corpus will be issued. And lastly, if you want to command a public officer from performing a public duty, then the writ of mandamus will be issued. Thank you.
Dharmi, thank you very much for explaining the five type of writs. Was it really? People are confused कि कौन से हमें कौन सा reduce करने का है तो आपने बहुत अच्छे से बोला thank you for that and this is a small token for you
thank you sir